Joining me around the table, Steve Inskeep, host of NPR's Morning Edition, Peter Beinart, columnist for Haaretz and contributing editor at The Atlantic, CNN political commentator LZ Granderson, and Michael Crowley, no relation, foreign affairs correspondent for Time magazine. Thank you all very much. Okay, here's my overriding question, at least in terms of big picture. Cold War, Cold War, Cold War. People say, oh, this is the new Cold War. U.S.-Russian relations are terrible. Dianne Feinstein said on my show, yes, this is a Cold War. What does that mean?
Well, it's not exactly a perfect analogy because you don't have this great ideological overlay. I don't think Russia is pushing for a particular ideology at this moment, but you have great power politics. You have ethnic Russians outside the borders of the United States, and you have a Russian president who believes that his country should have influence over them and greater control over them. The United States fundamentally disagrees. That's classic old-time great power politics, really.
What do you think, Peter?
Right. The Cold War was a global struggle. Russia's not a global power anymore. But this, one of the cruxes of the conflict between the U.S. and the Soviet Union was always that Russia believed that it had the right to be in control of what it considered its sphere of influence. That sphere of influence is much smaller than it was during the Cold War. Remember, that sphere of influence extended all the way to East Berlin during the Cold War. Now Russia is simply trying to have control over areas that are part of the former Soviet Union. But the United States, arguing for self-determination and sovereignty, does not believe Russia should be able to have that leverage even over Ukraine, its next-door neighbor, and that's the heart of the conflict.
Let me read something, and I want to get you two to chime in, from the Wall Street Journal editorial this weekend talking about Putin. He's a would-be czar who has turned the Kremlin into an operation that resembles the KGB he once worked for. His ambition is to disrupt the post-Cold War status quo by restoring Greater Russia and becoming the dominant Eurasian power. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I think that's right. And I think that he feels as though, as do many Russians, that Russia was humiliated after the fall of the Soviet Union, that the United States and the West exploited Russia's weakness, actually tried to westernize Russia in many ways, expanded NATO to its border, threatened it, tried to render it impotent, and wants to restore that former glory. And I think he's quite cynical about the idea that there's an international order that he has to respect, and that the world is a certain, that there are certain Western rules that he has to obey. So I think his agenda is very much not to literally restore the former Soviet Union, which is not plausible, but essentially to say the world, to say to the West, you can't push Russia around anymore. And as long as oil prices are at $100 a barrel, and it looks like they'll be there for a while, he's got a lot of money. He has enough to prop up a fundamentally flawed and weak economy and to make people respect his strategic leverage, which he has.
Which is why you've seen so many little, I would say, thorns in the side of President Obama and this administration, with bringing in Snowden, but then also with the LGBT anti-gay laws that they had heading into the Olympics, and even with the outcry from the Globe, he still proceeded to go ahead and have those anti-gay laws, which was an affront to what was happening in the West. So I agree with you. This is just him doing anything that he could, large and small, to say, we're not like them, we're Russia.
And Michael makes a good point when he talks about Russia's strength and Russia's energy supplies. You interviewed Secretary Kerry, who diplomatically expressed some frustration. He said, I wish that some European countries would be a little more responsive on this. They can't because their interests are the same. And Russia sees its interests in the same way. And even though this is a monumental embarrassment for Russia, as that clears away, Russia's still supplying natural gas to a huge part of Europe, and that's part of the equation. That doesn't change.
And yet we have, I have to say, Prime Minister David Cameron wrote an editorial today where he was just as hard on Russia, just as hard on Europe as he was on Russia about the downing of the Malaysian airline. And in part, what he said was, the growing weight of evidence points to a clear conclusion. The MH17 was blown out of the sky by a surface-to-air missile fired from a rebel-held area. If it is the case, then we must be clear what that means. This is a direct result of Russia destabilizing a sovereign state, violating its territorial integrity, backing thuggish militias, and training and arming them. We must turn this moment of outrage into a moment of action. It's kind of a call to arms. He didn't mention Germany. He didn't mention. But, I mean, that's kind of what it was. And what you're saying is not going to happen.
Well, I think the question is, how much can the U.S. push Germany, especially at this particular moment, when U.S.-German relations have been terrible as a result of of these spy scandals. I mean, if you look at the history of the Cold War, when the West acted, it was primarily, usually, it was the U.S. and West Germany as the two most powerful countries. Germany has economic interests that they would have to overcome, more political resistance to a tougher stand on Russia than we have at home. And the question is,
its economic interest being that it buys energy from Russia.
Right. And the question is, with American popularity in Germany really suffering as a result of these spy scandals, do we have the leverage to convince a German leadership to do things that are less popular in Germany than they would be in the U.S.?
But do we even have the credibility to do so? If you remember in 2008 with China, with Darfur, we weren't as strong in coming out against China, supporting the terrorism that was happening there, killing hundreds of thousands, displacing millions. We were pretty silent from 2006 up until 2008. And it wasn't until me, Pharaoh of all people, really started to bring attention to what was happening there that the president then, George Bush, actually spoke up and that we actually saw more global pressure. But we were quiet on China because China is a huge investor in the United States, and we were very cautious of that relationship.
And think about the context in Europe right now. Unemployment is still very high in these European countries. They're still scarred from the financial crash. It's taken them a long time just to get out of recession. Their economies are not in good shape. So you have the issue of the energy supplies. They worry about retaliation from Moscow. The natural gas will be cut off. There's also just commerce. The French are building, I believe it's battleships or destroyers for Moscow. It's like a $1 or $2 billion project. There is just a lot of cash that's changing hands. And if you're a leader of one of these European countries, you're thinking, how much of a hit, if you impose sanctions on Russia, there's a cost to Russia, but there's a cost to your businesses. How much of a hit are we willing to take with our economy so fragile right now?
I want to get you in on this, but I want to sort of put a question in there, which is, I think what I'm hearing is this game changer is not at all.
There's an effort to change the game through this, and we should underline that that is actually the purpose of a lot of this discussion.
And by this, we mean the downing of
this airliner. Exactly. It's not about downing an airliner anymore. Even though Secretary Kerry told you a lot about the investigation and the evidence, it's not really about that. The question is, how, if at all, can the United States use this to advance its foreign policy concerns? It's not like people are all that mystified about what happened here anymore. It's not like there's going to be more airliners shot down. They've closed that route, essentially. It's not about that anymore. It's how can the United States use that? And I think we're arguing that the opportunities are limited. Doesn't mean they're not there. Something could happen, but it's really hard.
Right, and leverage it forces one to realize that there are limits to what we can expect here. Ukraine is not going to become part of NATO. Ukraine is never going to be a country that's going to be able to be defiantly hostile to the concerns of Russia. So, yes, in the best circumstance, we could get rid of these separatists and allow a government in Kiev that had sovereignty over its entire country. But that's only going to be possible if that government and its Western supporters send the message that it's not going to be. It can be an independent government, but it can't be an anti-Russian government.
There is something that can be done, too, that doesn't necessarily directly mean financially, and that is, we know that Putin is very, very proud of Russia. He wants to restore the glory, if you will. He got away with the Olympics, but he has the World Cup. Mm-hmm. If the European nations say, okay, we're putting this in play now, we won't show up.
Now you're really asking.
But if you wanted to use leverage, you're scrambling for what can you do that would help pressure Putin. That is something I would not take off the table.
Let me ask you all a wrap-up question here, and that is, a year from now, do you think anything will have changed vis-a-vis the U.S.-Russian relation, the U.S.-European relation, Europe's relationship with Russia, or is this a flash in the pan that settles back into status quo?
Well, my answer, with the caveat, it's very hard to predict, and don't bet any money on it, is that as long as this stays contained to Ukraine, I think not that much will have changed. If Putin, I think there is a sense we can live with this, we don't like it, but if he starts going into the Baltics or other parts of Europe, it's a different question.
Yeah, I think that makes sense. There's also the truth is that something has started in eastern Ukraine that Russia is fueling, but Russia doesn't have total control over. So we don't even entirely know that even if Russia were to pull back to some degree, we don't know that there isn't now some terrible momentum that started with partly criminal, partly ethnic in eastern Ukraine that has a life of its own.
A civil war. Yeah.
And years from now, we don't know who our president is going to be and what their policy is going to be and what their approach to foreign affairs is going to be. You know, President Obama has been very much a negotiator, if you will. We don't know if you get someone in who's more Senator John McCain than President Obama, what our rhetoric is going to be and thus what our actions will be.
And it's a reminder that if the president of Russia does not have full control of the situation, certainly the president of the United States does not necessarily have full control of the situation and has to bear that in mind.
Limits of what we used to call the New World Order.
Yeah.
Right? So it's Steve Inskeep, LZ Granderson, Peter Bangalore. Michael Crowley,
hey.
Sorry. I wish you'd change the pronunciation of Michael Crowley. Thank you all so much.
Right.
Thanks for joining us, all of you.
Thank you. Great to be here.
Thank you.